Let's talk about soulmates. Hey everyone, welcome back to today's podcast. My name is Brittany Simon. I'm so glad to have you here. If you're watching on YouTube, don't forget we are also on Spotify. And girl, I got like 100 downloads. And I know I'm a small ass channel, but that is a big feat for me. I'm like 100 humans have decided to literally go on Spotify and listen to me. I am blessed. Mostly because I've never used Spotify before and I felt very tech inept. I forget because I live on this little island of the internet that, I don't know, for me, I worry so little about like the huge numbers, and I'm just so grateful to have the individuals watching me and then conversing with me. So in the comment sections today, guys, please feel free to give your comments. I'd like to read them. It makes my whole day. If you want to even comment for the algorithm, that would just help me out so much. I really appreciate it. Sometimes if you're feeling motivated and you want to spice it up, if you share your favorite anime quotes or inspirational quotes or something funny, that would be fun too. I think we should definitely start that theme on YouTube of people posting, at least on my channel. If you don't want to comment on the subject matter, something to share. I think we have forgotten how to share with people without it coming from a negative place. Have you noticed on the internet there is so much, oh, did you see this guy fuck up attitude going on, that we forget to share things that also make people's day. I'm so grateful to have such good friends who often send me the cutest videos, just reminding each other that life's pretty good, we're gonna be okay, everything's gonna be fine. Now, I want to talk about soulmates to continue this month of February, this month of love. Soulmates are such a weird thing because depending on your culture, you could have different definitions for what a soulmate is. For the sake of this conversation, my definition of a soulmate, whoops, dropping my pen here, is somebody who is connected to you in a particular way and you are connected to them and you feel a draw to them, a uniqueness of sharing something that makes you feel like this person might be different than everyone else and I don't even know why yet. And then it gets to a point where you realize, oh, you're sort of like a version of me, if you will, or a version of some similar energy in the world where we mix harmoniously together. I left it pretty vague because bear with me, I'll give you examples and I don't know how else to say it. Sometimes I feel like English, or at least my vocabulary, doesn't always have all the greatest words to communicate what I am thinking, but I'll give you an example. In my early 20s, I went to Torrey Pines in San Diego. It's like a golf course. It's a really beautiful place off the cliffs. Down below is Black's Beach, the nude beach in California. It's a really beautiful area of San Diego. And I went with a bunch of friends. It was a dapper night. So how do I explain this? Because maybe it just sounds weird, but throughout my life, I've had different friend groups. I had one in my 20s that was a collection of liberal and conservative political youths who all, for whatever reason, were drawn to politics and then, of course, to each other. And we all ended up meeting up and having great political discussions and adventures and running around and being really silly. And it was just like a lot of fun. A hot mess of drama, but fun. And I remember one time we all decided, okay, guys, we're going to dress up like dappers. We're going to fucking go to Torrey Pines. We're going to have a great time. We're going to have duck. We're going to spend so much money. Let's go. And we did. It's a very expensive place. We spent a whole crap ton of money. I remember I had duck pate and like a few other things that I thought were really interesting. And then we just ran around. You know, we ran through the golf course. We skipped in the dark. We giggled. We just ran around. Well, there was a woman there. And she was very tall and very adorable. And I just walked right up to her. And I said, I'm very attracted to you. And she was like, oh, I'm straight. And I was like, oh, you know, what does this mean? I have been best friends with that girl for all of these years. Like, we are decade plus into friendship. She's one of my closest, most inner circle. She's one of my chosen family. She's come to my house to cook cookies with my mom. So, you know, she's a homie. Like, she's special to me. And we were bonded with each other. There was a whole group of us guys, like 20 people. And for whatever reason, we were just drawn to each other. And we've maintained this friendship that is very just wonderful. I can't even explain to you how good it is. She's so smart and so wise and so wonderful. And though we disagree on how we tackle issues and all these things, we have one of the most amazing conversations. We have great conversations. She's very open, very non-judgmental. I can basically say anything to her and she will consider within context of my character where I'm coming from. That is so rare to find in society. It's rare to find from friends. It's rare to find from most social groups. The reason I want to specify why this is different is because this is what makes her one of my soulmates and vice versa. My other soulmate is the same. He's a guy, and he, you know, he's somebody that came towards me. And I remember the first time I talked to him, I was like, I don't really understand why that conversation went the way it did. It was different. I remember getting off the phone call with him, and my partner at the time asked me, was it just some guy trying to get into your pants? And I was like, no, it wasn't. We talked about ideas, and we were like, what is this? And to this day, it's one of my most favorite friendships. And he is also in my inner circle. He's somebody that I have like adopted as my chosen family to come in. And he is somebody who, again, we're drawn to each other. We have just incredibly authentic and real conversations. We really see each other like in the most honest, true way. Like, it doesn't matter what is happening or what sentences are said. We know each other so well. It's beautiful. And there's nothing romantic between us, like no sexual attraction. We literally are into completely different girls, like different styles, different humans, like, but we love each other so much. So I thought that was interesting, right? So now two soulmates and no sexual attraction. The third soulmate that I want to talk about is my best friend of 20-something years, who, again, was the last person on our block that you would think we would be best friends. She's, like, polar opposite of me in so many ways, in personality and attitude and, like, lifestyle. She would just never do the things I do. But at the same time, we do a lot of the things we do together. Like, we have so many good memories together. She knows me so well. Chosen family, inner circle. Somebody who, no matter what I say, what she says, how we communicate with each other, we always know we're gonna be fine. We always know that we have each other's backs. It doesn't matter if I called her right the fuck now and was like, get here now, I need you. She would get in her car and come to me. She doesn't care. Zombie apocalypse, pandemic, don't give a shit. And that's your inner circle. Your inner circle are people who defy the world to do what's right by their friends and their family. Or at least, you know, that's just how I think about it. And then, of course, over time, I have found other people that I'm like, I think they might be my soulmates, but we have a different kind of relationship. We have one where we don't always have to talk about everything, but we could. And then the way we talk to each other is just like, it's very explorative, guys. It's very connecty. It's very woo-woo, but forgive me, I have no other way to explain something that is also woo-woo in context, right? The idea that one person is made for you. Now, in other cultures, they might think of the soulmate as the one. I was raised Catholic and in a Middle Eastern culture and American culture. So my parents and my brother, and I've asked a lot of the devout Catholics in my family, what are soulmates to the Catholic Church? And the way they've kind of explained it is the way that it was mimicked to me, which is there are millions of soulmates for you, millions of people that God could have created for you, millions of people that the universe could have brought to you. But you meet your soulmates along the way. And then, you know, most of the time we end up just picking the first soulmate that's romantic and marrying them. Or you have soulmates that are platonic. I definitely see that with my siblings. I definitely see that with other family members where I'm like, yo, that's your soulmate, dude. That's like your homie soulmate. I think maybe we dilute our friendships in America. We dilute our relationships so much that people think a soulmate is the person that makes you want to text them all the time, or the person who smothers you, or the person who is maybe more superficial with you. But I would like us to explore the idea of a soulmate being something very, very important and something very, very needs to be honored, something that needs to be respected. The soulmates that I have in my friend circles versus romantic partners. And I have to say, I don't think I've had a romantic soulmate in my opinion. I thought I had, but I think in observation, it was clear that I never did. And so that's kind of weird, right? That's like a weird assessment to come to, that I could have loved somebody that wasn't a soulmate. And maybe that's what we do wrong. Maybe in life, we keep falling in love with people who aren't our soulmates. And that's why we don't feel fulfilled in our friendships or relationships. Because I'll tell you, my parents are definitely soulmates. Like 120 million bazillion percent. There is just, I cannot explain to you when I see them. My best friend's parents, she 100% her parents are soulmates. Like, I look at them and we always ask our parents, you know, like, how did you meet? Why did you date? What brought you guys together? And it's always the guy saying something like, well, you know, I was lucky enough she noticed me. And the girl's always saying, I was lucky enough he carried me away. It's like this mutual respect of, we're so glad we were there for each other in whatever way, in whatever hokey way we want to explain it. But there are these, well, I just made my hair's drying still from my shower. Sorry for people who are watching the visual right now. I touched my hair and it completely distracted me. But to get back onto soulmates. So I wrote down some notes for how I want to communicate, I guess, the way to observe whether or not you're near a soulmate. And I think a big part of it is the physicality of your energy. I know this sounds really strange, but like your body, like just like pay attention to the stress in your shoulders, the stress in your mind. How does it feel when you're around that person? What draws you to them? You know, I've been really lucky that in my life, I have had great opportunities to date, interact with a lot of people. And I've been asked out by a lot of really great people over the years who I just was not interested in. And a lot of people might say, like, well, they're really good people, so why not give them a chance? But for me, giving a person a chance is to consider hearing them out and then weighing the pros and cons to what I feel towards them. I know myself pretty well. If I don't feel like an initial attraction to you in any capacity, like a need to constantly message you or need to, you know, feel safe around you initially, there's usually some reason for that. And I might not have the reason for it, but it's much easier, I think, to detect things we don't like than things we do like, especially if it's an unknown. But my life has given me an opportunity to talk to thousands of people. I've met so many people, like talked to so many people. People are beautifully individualistic, but not that hard to categorize into tropes. So if I'm interacting with somebody who's like, oh my God, guys, like, have you seen my eyelashes and my makeup today on fucking Fleek Point? Yes. Oh my God, lit as fuck. Like, right. That's not, we're not gonna, what is that connection to somebody like me who, yes, I might use the same language, but the tone, the priority, the way it interacts, it's different. And that's just like a superficial example. But I'm going to tell you right now, the outward of it is going to indicate to me whether or not to engage. And then the reality of it is going to be in what happens next. So, okay, stay with me here. Let's see if I can explain this. When we're socializing, we are constantly fighting our brain's need to guess the future. So let's say you're interacting with somebody. And in my head, I say, well, I've already interacted with this girl. She sounds ditzy as hell. Not into it. Right? And then I don't engage. Well, two things are going to happen. Either that girl's going to back off or she's going to push harder. If she pushes harder, that solidifies my initial. If she respects and backs off in a real way, then that's just a person that I can respect and we can go our own ways. Neither indicate a need to cause action on my end, right? And when we do that, we're making choices based off of what's happening in the most, I think, reasonable way possible. But what happens if you're interacting with this person and your initial thought of them was wrong because their reaction to you was actually what you do respect in a person, and then that makes you want to engage? Are you a girl who's playing hard to get? Are you somebody who, with new information, is making an educated decision? And I think we need to talk about that. Often when we talk about love or socialization or interactions, there's a lot of us predicting the future and a lot of us living in the past. And so you need to be really secure in how you're going to move forward in this. One of the ways, I guess, I think of soulmates is sort of the Sex and the City way of thinking of soulmates. If you want to reference something, I was going to say like pop culture, but is pop culture current culture? Because it's definitely not current. But in Sex and the City, there's an episode where all the girls are sitting down and talking about how they're each other's soulmates. And I think without a doubt that's true. When you have friendships that good, when you know people that well, when you're homies like that, like the core group, it's like your soulmates. You know when you watch an anime and there's like the main group and then there's like the sort of friends and then there's like the teachers, there's like the other people, the wise people, the senseis, whatever. Those people are all, we all love the side characters. But like, you know how there's like the core group? Like, okay, let's just take Pokemon. There's like Ash, Misty, and Brock. That's our main trio, right? They're soulmates. They're like homies. They're like brought together. And then there's all the people around them who we love, like Professor Oak, right? Like he's chill. We like him. Gary, he's like a dick, but we kind of love him. But like they're not the main group. And so there's a reason for that. There's a way to exist in the world where we can socialize with a lot of nice people or good people that we're not meant to be with. And I think we force that. I wanted to do a review of the Abba and Preach video that came out recently about the martial arts lady who Joe Rogan was interviewing, because something about the way that they were thinking about it was really bothering me. And I made this video and I didn't write come out exactly how I wanted. So maybe I'll redo it later. But I'll just touch on this right now. The title of the video was basically something, and I'm paraphrasing, like, she breaks up with a nice guy because of this, you know. And Abba was really upset. Like, Abba was just so mad. And there's this narrative that men who have been hurt by women are men who are bitter towards women. And Abba, obviously, he's been the cheater. He's obviously been hurt. He holds a lot of that past in his heart. And I know that he has a potential to get better and heal from it, but right now he's still hurt. So he tends to be he takes it personal. And he's like, see, girls don't want nice guys. See, like, she's like, she ditched him for that, right? But no one's saying these girls are perfect either. Because the problem is that it indicates something is wrong on all of us when we don't know what we want and communicate poorly. But when we also think that the only qualification to be in a relationship is to have a nice person date you, as if that's a fluke, as if people aren't mostly nice. The world is full of mostly nice people, mostly good guys, mostly good women. We can't date all of them, and we aren't compatible with all of them. If they're, you know what I mean? And I think the frustration I have is that so many people think love is like a resume contract or you're a relationship with a roommate, which for you it might be, but that's not what I'm talking about. I'm not talking about dating a girl and then constantly worrying if she's going to take your money, or dating a guy and constantly worried if he's going to beat you. Are we so unhealthy as a country, as a nation, that we think all dating comes with some sort of emotional abuse? Like, I don't understand what went so wrong, except y'all don't have moms and dads with good relationships. Because I'm going to be real. If that's true, which the science supports, then we've got to start being better at recognizing what damage we're harboring and what damage we're continuing. If you're preaching from a pulpit that all women are this or all men are that, you've already failed. And I'm not saying Abba and Preacher are doing that at all. I like them. I like their content. Just like I have 5 or 6 people that I watch constantly that I like. But to say that we're not tackling these from different perspectives and there's a lot of subjectiveness to this would be ignorant. So when we're talking about a soulmate, when we're talking about somebody that we love, we have to first recognize that the politics of your culture shouldn't play as much of a role in the love between you so much as the functionality between you. And these are very different things. They are very different things. If you were born at a time where interracial marriage was illegal in the States and you were dating somebody who was a different, you know, ethnicity of you than you, you can think of the politics of how that impacts your love, but that shouldn't dictate how you love each other necessarily. And I think that's very important. And also, I think what is clearly missing, people are so afraid, and I am too. I get really anxious when people push me. So I know what I want. I'm in my 30s. I just need about an hour with somebody, and I know whether or not I want to continue that relationship. And I've had a lot of interactions with this month. February is making everybody come out of the woodworks, and I get it. But the problem is because, and to talk about that parasocial relationship a little bit with love, because everyone's watching me and I'm not watching you, the fact that like a dozen people reached out to me to ask me out this month in some capacity is weird. That doesn't normally happen. So I'm like, okay, what's going on? Like, why are people clinging to a girl they don't know on the internet? Because y'all don't know 90% of my life, right? Like 90% is a lot to not know about somebody. You know, and YouTube's a place of PC culture. You don't even know half the stuff I'm thinking in my brain. So when you guys come to me and you do like calls with me, which I love, 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 and you tell me about yourselves, I'm listening. I'm really listening. So when you say certain things, I'm thinking in my head, okay, they're these people. And like, oh, they believe in this. And this is the category of belief they have. And oh, this is how we're different. I'm not thinking about dating you. I'm thinking of you as an individual and an adult, but I'm also aware of how we differ because I'm not looking for friends from my audience, right? It's not that I'm opposed to making friends. It's just that I'm not on YouTube to like make friends. I'm on YouTube to definitely talk about my work and to most likely meet a spouse, but it's not like I've been on YouTube for over 10 years. I don't dedicate most of my life to my job for any other reason than I love my job at its core. I love these discussions. So I've been having these really weird interactions lately where people are hitting on me and I don't know why, because we don't have much in common. We have a perceived amount in common. Now, one person in particular, you know who you are, Snapchat me later, send me an anime meme, was great. Like, one person is like the example of like how it was pretty nice and really good, and we needed like a couple dates, and then I was like, I'm good. And the funny thing about that date was the reason I needed a couple dates versus like an hour with that person was because they didn't just vomit information at me. They didn't spend an hour just telling me their whole life. They had a discourse with me and a back and forth, and they weren't there to like showboat me. They were there to get to know me. So now we friends, and now we get to play Overwatch together, and now we get to talk about anime together, because we took like there was an actual like conversation happening. What happens usually, and this is totally fine, my brother uses this method on first dates, is that some people will just vomit their whole resume to you, and then you can on that first date know whether or not you're interested. Like, my brother always did that on dates, and that's how he got married, because on the first date he told this girl everything he was, and she was like, holy shit, me too. Then they compared notes, they met each other's families, they confirmed no one was lying, and then they got married, and they've been happily married and have 3 kids. But that's not everyone's method. Like, for me, I'm fine with either method. I don't mind. But if you vomit your information at me for an hour and give me enough reasons to be like, no, 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 then it's easy for me in that hour to be like, I'm good. Now, we need to jump from soulmates, which is that energy feeling, that mystical thing that comes in all shapes and forms in all cultures that draws you to a person. And let's talk about the superficial ways you can reject a person or know to reject a person. So there is, and I have some notes, I wrote down 3 specific examples because I was laughing with a friend and we were talking about, you know, like what petty things would I be like, oh, if they do this, I'm not dating them. Like, a lot of people make it about politics. Oh, if they vote this way, I'm not going to date them. I'm less concerned with politics. I don't think who you vote for tells you much about who you are as a person, because there's basically every conceivable reason to vote for just about anybody. So it's not really a good indicator. Like, if this was a science experiment, that would be a very poor indicator. But what's a good indicator? The people. Listening to the people who are conveying to me who they are. We use clothes, fashion, logos, our cars. We use a lot of things to communicate to people who we are. Not all the time, but some of the time. And you can usually tell when someone's trying to communicate to you versus somebody who's just living their life. Like, my car is no stickers, no logos. There's nothing on my car that tells anyone anything about me, which I like. I'd like to be inconspicuous. The only thing that's interesting about my car is that it's an SUV that always has mud on it, and it has a tow hitch. So somebody might think, oh, a tow hitch on an SUV? She must be pulling a trailer. Something like that could occur. But in general, my car is very basic. I do not like it to be flashy. I drive a Honda CR-V. It's silver. It looks like a mom's car. Very basic car. But the other day, I thought to myself, what could a person put on their car that would make me 100% know I'm not going to date them or want to fall in love with them? Here we go. Here we go. If somebody has a sports logo on their car, I'm out. The other day, I was driving and I saw a Raiders car. It was a truck, all suit, like, just like fucking beautiful, right? Beautiful truck. But fucking Raiders logos everywhere, on the back, on the fucking like bed of the truck, everything, just like fucking Raiders. And I thought to myself, like, this is my nightmare. This is literally my nightmare of a person. Not because sports are bad, not because this person is bad, but because the idea of having a Super Bowl party almost makes me upset, because I cannot sit down for sports. In my head, I want to be a person who likes sports. But unless it's the X Games, I just don't care about football, baseball, anything. I've got my best friend, the third soulmate I mentioned. She's taken me to so many baseball games. Okay, I grew up in Orange County. We went to the Angels, you know, stadium. We did our shit as kids. Like, we all went over there. We all, like, you know what I mean? Her parents love sports. They love sports. They're always telling me to get into sports. I just, like, I don't have it in me, right? I don't. It's not a criticism of the person doing the sports. It's me respecting who they are and who they're telling me they are. They're letting me know, I love sports so much, I just spent $500 or more literally transforming my vehicle into a Raiders transformer. I have to respect this. I have to respect that they are letting me know who they are. I really hope that makes sense. I'm really not trying to be completely judgy. I'm just trying to judge in accordance to my observation to move me forward. The other examples I used was, I wouldn't date somebody who gets tattoos, but I would date somebody who has tattoos. Here's the difference. I'm a good example. I have tattoos. I most likely at this point will probably not get more. And the reason I say that is because I only get tattoos that like really are significant, and there's just nothing else I need right now that makes any sense for me to get. There are things I could get. I love tattoos. I love the like aesthetic of tattoos. I would love like, heck, I even think about giving myself a sleeve. Like, I love that idea. That was actually originally, this was going to be my Disney arm. But then I just decided, you know what? I'd rather just buy a house. I'd rather invest in other things. I don't want to put more money towards something that I just like, I'm indifferent to. But I know a lot of people who will spend for the rest of their life thousands of dollars getting different kinds of tattoos, covering some up, removing some, getting new ones. That's fine. Love me, my tattoo humans. Love you, fam. But it's a lifestyle choice. It's me conveying to the world, this is what I invest my time into. The same way I wouldn't date a girl or a girl, because I definitely wouldn't date a guy who wore makeup in a James Charles way. I'm open to dating a guy who wears makeup in like a My Chemical Romance way, but not all the time. Like, that's the thing. I know who I am as a default, and my default is sweatpants, hoodies, anime, like clothes, and like my hair just like doing my thing. Like, my hair's just down right now, right? It's not doing nothing. So I know I want somebody who's similar, so my house can be more like cohesive. Because what I've noticed is that for me, people who are vastly different from me as a partner, just they start to get on my nerves. Like, if I was dating a girl that wouldn't leave the house because she didn't have makeup on, I would kill myself. That is like, I cannot handle that. I'm a girl who's like, I don't give a fuck. Like, I have a camping car. I want to go camping and be dirty and not shower for 2 weeks because we're out in the mountains hiking. Like, I want to be adventurous. So I can't have a girl that's like, honey, I can't leave the house unless I have my eyelashes on. Like, how is that going to serve our energies? Is it a criticism of her? No, I don't care that women want to wear tons of makeup or men want to look like James Charles. I'm not opposed to your ability to be happy. I'm just letting you know it's not mine, and it would do us both a disservice to add our energies into a relationship that would cause friction. Now, other people can do this. I am not this person. So if you like, I believe opposites attract. I do not believe they stay together as the rule. I believe they are the exception. I believe opposites who maintain relationships, who, I mean, in terms of values, lifestyle, like the emo marrying the preppy girl, like that kind of extreme opposites, those people are a rarity, and I'm not that special. I'm gonna be real. I'm a very normal person who's a little weird, kind of weird, a lot of weird, but I'm pretty normal. You know what I mean? I just want a cohesive existence. So again, we're not criticizing. We are observing to benefit us. The second example I gave was dating somebody who is vegan because they can't be intimate with me. So I talked to Kyoti about this. I love vegan food, love vegan restaurants, love vegan people, have dated vegans, love, love, love the vegan. Do not want to marry a vegan because cooking is my love language and I like meat. I eat meat all the time. Sometimes I just eat meat. I'm like Sokka and Sasha. If they had a baby, I would have been their baby. I like meat. And my way of cooking is to feed people. My way of showing love is to cook for people. So I couldn't be in a home with a girl or a guy or whatever. And, you know, I wouldn't want to make two dinners. I wouldn't want to make them food and then me food. I wouldn't want them to have to make their own food. It's just family and eating is so important to my culture. If you come to my mom's get-togethers and you are vegan and then you don't, like, it's just, it's okay if you're vegan. She'll have vegan food for you, but it's, then you're other. And that's fine. Like, that's not, again, we're not criticizing people who are other. We're criticizing that in my relationship, I would like somebody who can share this intimacy with me. And again, this is what I'm trying to get everyone to do in their own lives. Are we choosing partners who share these moments with us so we can build intimacy? Or are we choosing people that basically when we live with them, they're like roommates? We can't eat the same food, be together, sleep together. Like, okay, I need complete lights off in my house. Complete, like when I'm sleeping, unless I'm having nightmares and I'm afraid of the dark. Yes, I'm 31 and that still happens. Then I want pitch black darkness. I like to sleep in complete no lights, no computers, no like chargers, nothing. Darkness. If I had a partner who wanted a sound machine or lights, I would never sleep in the same room as them. I don't want this. And I know this happens. I know it happens, and it's not a judgment. It's an observation of what what are we truly willing to do to be with a person who is just like so different from us, right? And again, I understand that, and all these people are nice. In all of these scenarios, everyone's a good person, right? This isn't about ethics of like, oh, are these bad people or toxic people? This is just, can we even choose the basics of the good things about these things? Or as an example, I've been hit on by a lot of young people lately. And I think my audience might be, I mean, it's mostly like in your 20s, 30s. But one of the distinctive differences I've had to communicate to people is like, I'm looking to buy a house. Like, I'm talking to a bank. I'm paying off my debt to buy a home this year. So people who are in their early 20s and you're like in college or figuring yourself out or just discovered this about yourself, or you're in a completely different world than I am. And I can't be dating people who are still discovering those things about themselves, right? So it's like, for me, we talked about this on Patreon. I most likely will only be willing to date people who are like 28 at the youngest, maybe 29, and then all the way to like 40 maybe, because then we'll be in the same generational 10 years. We'll have an opportunity to have been raised similarly. And of course, they'll be at a place where they're also ready to like buy a house, or maybe they already have a house, or maybe they're more stable. Everyone has a different life, and some people have homes at 22. But the point is, if you're the kind of person and you're thinking, oh, I'm going to hit on Brittany, or I'm going to go attract, you know, I'm moving towards not even Brittany, just like somebody, and there, you guys are in two different places in your life. The attraction is there, but is the stability for a healthy and long-term relationship there? And I think that's what people forget. Like, I'm living where I want to live now. I'm buying a house where I want to live now. People who are like still like, I want to live in the city, or maybe Paris, or I don't know what, I don't want to put down roots because I'm single. I'm not in that headspace. I'm putting down roots to prove to my future partner I'm coming with something. I'm coming with equity. I'm coming with no debt. I'm coming with a house. I'm coming with something. Well, I'll have the house debt, but you know what I mean? I'm coming with something of value, because my life has had value even as a single person. Because what it communicates to me when you're in like your 30s, like late 30s, and you haven't built a life for yourself because you're waiting for someone else, that just tells me you don't have enough confidence in putting down roots to say, even though I've put down roots, I want to be with you. So like, it's as if insinuating that because you've bought a house and a state, you can't date somebody because they might be somewhere else. I'm open to international dating. I'm open to dating anybody who's like me, right? I don't care where you're from or, you know, where you live. I care about that you're doing things with your life that's meaningful, that you're living, that you're not on hold, you know what I mean? Or that you're, does this make sense? So again, I'm using myself as an example because I've had all these experiences. But for those of you who have, you know, you're just experiencing it, just keep this in mind that these are the things that might happen. These are the situations you might be in. I mean, I've been in so many weird situations that sometimes I'm shocked that I've even had these opportunities, but I'm also blessed for it. Because look, now I can make this podcast. Now I have this wisdom to date healthier people. It's all really good in the end. So the next one is one I've used in the past, but I'll use it again. I won't date somebody who's deaf. I've done it before. It was a really cool experience, but I talk way too goddamn much, and I realized like it wouldn't be a cohesive relationship. It's not because they're deaf that I wouldn't stay with them. So it's not like, so I would date, this is what I wrote down. I wrote, wouldn't date someone who's deaf, would stay with someone who went deaf. Very different. So if I'm with somebody who went deaf, that's a very different experience. I've bonded with them. They're my person. This is a thing that's happened to us. Not a thing initially we started dating. Now, the funny thing about that is I was thinking about politics and religion. So I am so afraid that I'm going to marry. No, I'm not afraid I'm going to marry this person, because to be fair, I have a lot of vetting ways to vet people. But I guess one of my biggest fears was that I was going to marry somebody who like 10 years into our marriage decided they were going to like transition, or decided they were going to become Muslim, or decide they were like going to believe in God, or decide they were going to become anti like LGBT or something. Like, I have very specific beliefs about myself, and I want to know what it is going in. I'm open, like, and to preface this, because I know a lot of people are super confused about my views. I have no problem with like transbinary people dating me or anything like that. I have an issue with people dating me and saying they're cis and then changing their mind or like coming into themselves later, not because they're trans, but because it's a belief system that's too drastic to change. That's why I mentioned religion, because I'm also a person who doesn't believe in a God without very substantial, like you have to give me hardcore evidence, right? Otherwise, like there's no reason for me to believe in a God. Same thing, if my partner came to me and was like, hey, I'm going to change the fundamentals of our relationship and completely shift this dynamic by telling you I believe in the magical creature in the sky and I expect us to raise our kids this way. And I'm just going to sit there and be like, whoa, no. Because where I've come in my life, like I know that the belief systems I hold are no longer I believe this and then I find evidence. It's sorry, like this is the evidence. So this is like what I've come to accept as reality. Like we are humans on Earth. And then the subject, the like subjective, the nuance, the preference part of my existence has come through philosophy, those answers. I'm not trying to preach an objective truth about how you should dictate your relationships. I'm just trying to point out that there's a pattern of behavior happening in society where we are constantly matching and dating with people or COVID weddings. Have you seen the COVID weddings that are happening, peeps? Some of y'all are getting engaged in very few months, weeks with people you're meeting because you're all so lonely. And I'm with you. I am not different from you. I am just as lonely as everyone else in terms of wanting someone to hold that isn't one of my brothers. I am literally living with all family right now for over a year. So of course, all of us, especially those of us who actually like are, you know, we're used to having physical affection from people that is more adult, of course we're gonna miss it. Like of course there's going to be a feeling like, oh my God, I don't have this, of course. But we still cannot make poor decisions because of where we're at. At least that's for me. That's where my discipline comes in. So as an example, and I'm gonna be really honest with you, I personally, if I'm sober, I can make very reasonable decisions. If I am drunk or high and I am horny, if I go to a bar, I will just have sex with that person. Who is it? I will do it. Because when I'm drunk or high, what I forget is why I wasn't going to do that in the first place, which is why I think I have a hard time with a lot of like the girls who I've also been with or done stuff with or seen who hold that regret the next day. What they're holding the regret of is not being diligent about being sober before they partied. Because let me tell you, do I regret? Yes. The next day, have I regretted drunk or high sex? Yes. Not in a Me Too way, not in a rape assault way, in a literal, oh, fuck, I wasn't supposed to have sex with that person because that person gets clingy and that person brings drama. Oh, fuck. Fuck, fuck. Like that's what it's like. It's a very different energy than some of the ways that people are talking about sex. Like, well, I didn't even want to do it. I don't want to do it either, but I'm going to do it because I want this physical satisfaction. So again, it's not rape or assault. It's saying I didn't want to have sex with this person because they're dramatic. But when I'm sober or high, I'm like, ah, fuck it. It's like masturbation. You're feeling the feelings, right? You're feeling the excitement. You're thinking about the physicality. You're just thinking about getting off. And then when you're sober, you're like, do I like this person? Is this person funny? Am I attracted to this person? Is my brain aroused by this person? You have time to think. So again, it's about being self-aware. So I personally am not leaving this house drunk or high. Note to self. I don't get drunk, but like drunk, you know, usually. So like I get high every day though, and I'm not leaving this house high because I will have sex with anybody. The guy who pushes carts at Walmart, he's looking pretty sexy right now. I've really enjoyed how this February has gone. By the way, there is a snowstorm outside my window right now. And I say snowstorm, but it's just snowing. So I don't know the difference between like a snowstorm and a snowing, but it's snowing pretty heavy. And I'm just watching it happen. So if you notice on the visual on YouTube, my skin getting whiter or brighter, it's because the literal like snow and sun is like shifting. And I love it so much. Like I have no lights on in this room right now. It's just like purely the window I'm sitting by. And it's so beautiful to watch, guys. I've had such a beautiful February in terms of challenges, hardships, better intimacy with my friends and family, understanding myself better, and of course, communicating with you guys. I appreciate so much the input you guys give me. And I understand there's going to be moments where there might be boundaries crossed or things might go wrong. But I want you to know it's not that I take it personal. I just need to put down my boundaries. I need to make it clear that I'm an adult and you're an adult, and that when we express interest or attraction to one another in any capacity, you know, you got to take the L when I say no. And also, there's got to be a respectability factor here that I am a dominant figure on the internet. My audience primarily asks me for input. And so what you're having there is that parasocial relationship and that weird dynamic, even though we're all adults, right? I think people need to just remember that that also, that energy exists in our life, because what fundamentally it is, it's not the ethicism of power dynamics or, oh, she has more power. It's the idea of the fantasy. The person who has the bottom, because they live in a fantasy land of what to expect, can easily convince themselves of inappropriate behavior being appropriate or moving. It's the fantasy, guys. When you live in a fantasy land, you move in real life like it's a fantasy. And then when it bites you, you don't know why. And I think that's the hardest lesson I also had to learn in my 20s, was that I lived for people's potential. I dated people for their potential instead of just accepting who they are. When we dress ourselves, when we wear horns on our heads or get our split tongues or a goth or a preppy or a Catholic or a modest, and we display ourselves for the world, we're alienating ourselves. We're letting people know who we are. We're reminding ourselves who we are. I know every day that my choices inform people of who I am. Now, whether or not they can objectively observe me, that also ties into the fantasy. I love Abba and Preach, right? I talk about it all the time. I think they're very genuine. That's why I like watching them. We disagree on some things. I highly doubt someone like Abba would want to date somebody like me, because like I'm on OnlyFans, and I know he's talked about that in the past, right? And for me, like, I don't want to date somebody who's not a fan of like erotic art, because I go to erotic festivals. I have art in my room I've spent hundreds of dollars on buying of nude women, because I go to festivals and museums, and I travel and I go see a bunch of nudist groups, and like that's very important to me. And so we have to remember that even though some people might want to ship, or some people might want to say like, oh, that could go good though, is it? Is the fundamentals there? Are the fundamentals there? You know, I, how do I say this? I saw this, just to use an example, because I've stopped watching Frenemies, because at this point it's just Trisha and Ethan like validating each other's ridiculous ideas of the world, like not backed by any kind of reason. And I just can't handle the lack of introspection. So there's just like no reason for me to watch anymore, which is a bummer, but like, you know, whatever. But they said something that I thought was really funny, because Trisha was really mad that Jason wanted to kiss a guy for a skit. And Trisha was like, no, this makes me uncomfortable. And he goes, well, if you don't want me to do my job or do this, like, we got to break up. And she's like, how awful is that? And Ethan's like, yeah, I can't believe they didn't validate your insecurity about wanting your boyfriend to do his job. And then I was like, excuse me, this is the same bullshit Trisha got when Jason's ex-wife was like, you can't be nude on the internet, so you have to stop being nude. This woman makes six figures a month on OnlyFans. I don't know why they're dating. Like, if you have a person whose job makes you uncomfortable, why are you dating them? And vice versa. This isn't about some guy trying to like control a woman, or some woman trying to control a man, or validating each other's consent. This is about, why are you dating people that don't respect your job? I just don't understand that. You know what I mean? I already have a non-job. Like, my job is OnlyFans and YouTube, and I am really happy doing it. But I already have a non-job. Like, even a podcast is kind of a non-job. Like, it's a job, but in the world I live in, it's weird. It's still weird. Like, people, like, if my dad had to brag about all of our careers, he definitely probably wouldn't mention mine, which makes sense, because I'm also putting out content that he is against his religion. So you know what I'm saying? I don't know why we do this. My mom does this too. She'll be like, Betsy, I hope you marry a nice Catholic boy. And I'm like, Mom, why would you torture that boy that way? Why would you force that boy to be with somebody like me? I just don't understand this desire to be with people who are so, who we are bad for. Like, I would be so bad for a devout Catholic. And I respect them too much to insist that they date me. What's so good about me that they would ruin their whole relationship with God? Like, I just don't understand that at all. And it continues forward. How we pick people, how we decide in our brains, like, this is the person, this is the person. I think we need just to be more self-aware that we're attracted to parts of people, and we need to be calm about how we interact with those parts, because everyone is a mystery until you get to know them. There's only so much we can know. And it's fine, again, to use the petty stuff to be like, oh, they're goth. I'm not goth. I don't want to date a goth. That's fine. You know, to go from there and say, I don't want to date that person. And at the same time, you know what I mean? You just want to make sure you balance out your interest in someone, the fantasy of someone, and the reality of someone. I just don't want you guys to be put in positions, though you should, I guess, suppose, be organic and you'll learn from this. Just be introspective. Where you see someone and you think, oh, they're a nice person. I'm a nice person. I guess we'll get married. Not if your goal is to never get divorced. So I guess, yeah. Okay, let's take a break. I think I need some coffee. Let's take a break.
Hi, hello. Are you a loser who spends all their time on the computer pondering their own existence?
Me too.
Join us on Patreon for just a dollar to meet hundreds of people who are exactly like you, or nothing like you, or somewhat like you. On Patreon for just a dollar, you'll have access to live shows, collaborations, and conversations. Oh, and of course, photo shoots of me looking like a hoe. So join us there and enjoy the ride. Thanks. Bye.
And we're back, boys. So I just talked to my brother downstairs and I was like, do you believe in soulmates? And he's like, no. And I was like, okay. But we talked about, first of all, look how cute my mug is for the visual viewers. So we talked about people who make out with their dogs. And I've also decided to add this to the podcast to remind you that if you make out with your dog, do not ever attempt to make out with me. Disgusting. Like, disgusting. For that, I will judge you. Like, those people on YouTube who just have whole videos dedicated to them make it out with their dogs. Gross. Not cute. If Nimbus or if Indiana lick my face, even for a second, I scream and run to the bathroom and scrub it with soap. Those people who are like, dogs' mouths are cleaner so we can make out with them are just so weird. Like, so weird. And that's the thing. There's like this denial of like the different kinds of weirdness we are. Like, I don't know why people are obsessed with being other and then wanting everyone to find them attractive. I just don't understand that, because the reason I am other is so people don't find me attractive. Like, to some extent, I'm trying to weed out, to say to the world, please do not hit on me if you are these kinds of people. We will not be compatible. Like, I'm so lucky that I'm on YouTube in some ways, because I'm just, you know, I'm slowly weeding out people by making my opinions known. Like, the reason I'm sharing more and more about myself is to make it clear that if you're a person who's like super left woke, do not hit on me. If you're a person who's like super right wing, do not hit on me. I am not interested in you. We will not get along. We will not have good conversations at home. I will be annoyed. Like, if your whole identity, like, okay, example. Here are things I was thinking of, reasons, kinds of people I wouldn't date. If you're on Twitter right now and your Twitter bio has your pronouns on it, do not hit on me. If your Twitter bio currently has not my president, do not hit on me. If you're current Twitter bio includes things like, here's my Cash App. I'm like, you know, do not hit on me. Like, we're not in the same world. Like, we are not in the same world. We are not operating in the same reality. I'm not interested. Again, not as a judgment point, but as a honest point. I'm trying to literally give you the tools to survive the world. Please do not take this offensively. And that's the thing. Some people will. Some people will be like, is she saying that I'm a bad person for making out with my dog? No. I said you were a disgusting person, which is very different. It's the same way I feel about bananas. They're disgusting. Are they bad? No. They're a banana. Like, don't think that just because words are negative that they're saying you're a ethically bad person. Nobody's coming for you ethically. I'm coming for you where you are in your state of mind. And for me, like, I just don't value these things. Like, somebody asked me, like, because I had made the first podcast about, like, knowing yourself, man or boy or girl or whatever. And then people just automatically took it as, like, I'm not pro-trans rights. But, and where did I say I'm not pro-trans rights? How can you not live in a world where you are both pro-trans rights and don't understand non-binary people, or you're pro-trans rights and still don't think people are trans? Like, that, I'm not saying I think that, I'm just saying, like, I don't understand why people need people to validate them. If you know you exist, what does it matter if other people do, as long as you have the legal right to be yourself, to whatever extent that means? Because I definitely don't want the NAMBLA people coming at me. Well, I think kids are attractive, so it's like pedophile Ben Shapiro's over here. Not that Ben Shapiro is a pedophile, that's not what I'm saying. But you know what I mean? We, for whatever reason, I don't know why, we like this challenge. And so we go for people, like the good girls go for the bad guys. I don't know why. And then the bad guys go for the good girls because we're like, ooh, look at the thing I can do. It's like, ugh, that's not interesting to me. It's funny because, you know, I've rolled on all sides of YouTube. I've talked to all kinds of people. And I was watching fucking Sargon of Akkad, Carl Benjamin. And Carl and I, Carl is so funny. I literally attributed one conversation we had to impacting my belief system in the way that thousands of conversations have. And Carl was legit like, Brittany Simon's giving me the credit. And I was like, I'm not giving you all the credit, you bitch. And like, that's the thing is like, I'm sitting here, like, I'm not giving him the credit for like changing my worldview. I'm saying he contributed like thousands of other people. It was impactful, but it wasn't the sole reason I changed my mind on ideas. But Carl and I differ very heavily on the purpose of truth and philosophy. And one of the things we differ on is like sex work. Cause I've watched his videos on like OnlyFans. And when he talks about this, he's talking about like the, like how OnlyFans isn't good and it's not. And it definitely isn't for a lot of people. Like porn is definitely not good for a lot of people. I wouldn't say most people, but it's not the porn that's the issue. Just like guns. Like a lot of people are nervous about guns because of who has them. Not because of who has them, but because they have guns. And I'm more concerned about who has guns. And I'm mostly just concerned about like crazy people who have guns. But in general, most humans do okay. Like in a country that is so full of guns and everyone is so afraid of guns, we're doing pretty good. Like I know the school shootings sound really horrible and people are really upset about them. But again, are we observing these things in an objective way or subjective way? Swinging this back over to love, in relation to Carl Benjamin, he says that like virginity is valuable. And I've been really thinking about that, like thinking about that idea. And I guess because I don't value virginity, I don't quite understand it in a rational way, but I can understand it from like a spiritual perspective. And I've been thinking about that too, because I grew up Catholic and a lot of people have this stereotype that Catholics, you know, once you're gay or once you're, you know, sleeping outside of marriage, you're just like shunned. And yeah, maybe in like the 50s, bro, but it's 2021. So what usually happens is they're like, oh, you shouldn't have done that. Go to confession and don't do it anymore. And then that's what people do. And they do it because it's like your goal is something bigger than yourself. But I've been thinking about virginity in terms of love as just like a tenet. Like I am definitely not a virgin. I've been with like I've been sexually active with about 15 people, boys and girls. And that alone makes it so I'm not attractive to a whole subset of the human population, not just America. I know Americans like to think everyone is America, but not just us. I mean, like Muslim cultures wouldn't want to engage with me, Christian cultures. I don't know about other religions, but I know like, I mean, that's 2 billion people right there. Like there are a lot of humans that would look at me and say, ooh, you know what? That's outside my bounds of reality. So instead of being all, you have to be a virgin or you don't have to be a virgin or you have to be this or you have to be this, you have to decide within your bubble what you're supposed to be. When I reviewed Ben Shapiro's sister, who I'm sorry, I just don't know her name. I think it's like Abigail or something. Abby, something like that. She gave her statement about modesty for her community. It's not really objective. Like I saw a lot of feminists going after her, a lot of left wingers who going after her because she said something about leggings being sexy. And these girls were like, leggings aren't sexy. And I was like, I'm sorry, y'all never seen me in leggings because I look sexy as hell. That shit wraps around my ass. It like sinks in. It's like I'm going to make on OnlyFans. This is what I've decided this week. I'm going to make some leggings gifts. And then I might even make a video on YouTube showing you how sexy I look in leggings. Because if y'all sit there and honestly tell yourselves that girls wearing leggings don't look sexy, then you ain't looking at the right girls, because I'm not gonna lie, I've never not looked sexy in leggings. They're sexy. Now, are they modest? Sort of. If modesty is showing skin, yes. If modesty is showing figure, no. Because I grew up in a household where like your figure was much more sexy than like your like just like having shorts on. Have you seen my figure? It is gorgeous. But that's the thing, is when you have like a more womanly body like me, you automatically look more primally attractive. My best friend is a ballerina professionally. She has a ballerina's body. Very athletic, very flat-chested, very muscular. She wears a shirt with a low cut. No problem. No sexuality. No one just like oogles her boobs or looks, you know, me automatically a slut. It's been that way since I was a kid. So again, what we're attracted to matters. As an example, I was thinking about clothing with a signal. So even though I have boobs and a womanly figure, if I dressed more modest, if I covered up my breasts, if I did more things that were more like conveyed a more conservative tone, it would attract more conservative people, right? I don't think guys in LA are going to go for girls who look like they came out of Amish country. And maybe they would, but I live in a place with a lot of like old school Mormons, and they look like old school Mormons. I mean, they got the clothes and the hair, and like they look like the people you see on TV, and you're like, oh, look at that. I'm not going to date that. That's a person signifying to me that they live in a completely different world than I do, and it would be inappropriate for me to hit on them. So as we're rattling all these ideas off in our head, I think it's important to think of life as less like, oh, people don't love me for me because I'm different, and more like, I'm glad those people don't love me, like don't feel forced to love me for not who I am. Does that make sense? I don't know how else to really convey my trouble, my concern with the world right now, but it feels very much like we're all just we're just hitting on everybody and hoping someone says yes to us, instead of being selective and saying, you know what, for the health of my sanity, I'm going to appropriately pick my partners. And I know that Tinder's not helping, because you're just like, oh, they're cute, I'll go out with them. And then you get there and you realize, according to studies, they said like over 50% of people are lying on those apps anyways. So again, I don't know how you want to go about life, but I want to do it with my self-interest in mind. I want to do it with my mental health in mind. I want to do it with my happiness in mind. And I can't do that if I keep living in a delusional world where I demand everyone finds me attractive or everyone validates my existence, because that in turn invalidates theirs. And I don't think I am so important that I need to invalidate other people's worldviews. As long as we all learn to live together in this beautiful chaos of diversity, I'm happy. I'm good. Please understand that no matter what I say when I say it, I'm speaking from two perspectives. The objective perspective of my belief systems that inform how I see the world, and that reality that we all live together. And so I will tolerate you. I will absolutely tolerate your existence. I just ask that you tolerate mine. And then when we're falling in love, I don't know that you should be tolerating your partner. I really don't like that idea that we need to tolerate our partners. I think instead we should be with people that we respect, that we see eye to eye on, and that we share a true understanding of existence with. But maybe that's just me, because that's what I see in my life. Maybe for me, the relationships that I mimic my life on, that are all 30 years plus together, that's what they did. And it seemed to work out pretty good. So I'm going to try that. And I have a feeling it's going to work out okay. And I'm pretty happy about it. Guys, how did you feel about this podcast? How did you feel about that little break? Was that weird? I hope that's okay. Maybe I just need to be more honest with my inability to sit down for too long before I have to get up again. So maybe I'll just do the podcasts where I have like little breaks, and it's kind of nice, but still long form and still free flowing. No script, just notes. You know what I mean? Not that I script my videos anyways, but this is nice. If you guys want to stay for another few minutes, I'm just going to update you on some things that are going on. So the snow is here. It's clearing up. I have some travel plans coming up in a couple of places. I have some photo shoots I'm going to do, some animes I need to finish, some books I have to finish. But I've been really brainstorming some ideas for Discord on Patreon. I want to do a couple of reading sessions where I just like log on and start reading, mostly to force myself to sit still long enough to finish one book. Because right now I'm reading like 10 different books, and I'm not getting far enough in the books to feel good. So I want to just sit down and have like an hour. So I was thinking about doing that. But then I was thinking, because 2 months ago on Patreon, I think it was, we did this thing where we did like a live gathering on Discord and just hung out and talked. That was nice, but not enough people showed up. So I'm like, okay, how do I do this? Like, how do I get people to get together? And then I don't always go live on YouTube. I'm only doing it like once a month right now, just because I'm really trying to do any extra stuff to like pay homage to Patreon. But also, I do lose my spoons. I'm doing a lot right now, so I'm trying to balance that. As many of you guys know, I also have had like some deaths in the family, and so we're just kind of moving through those emotions. But in general, life is good. Everything feels good. I'm a little tired, but in general, life is still beautiful. There's still a lot of hope in the world, a lot of goodness happening, a lot of good people doing good things. And there's, I think, when you're not on the internet and you're just talking to your neighbors, I think you'll really start to focus on like, okay, people in general, we're doing pretty good. You know what I mean? And just to revel in that. If your February is feeling less romantic every day since V-Day already passed, remember to keep it up. Remember that every day is a blessing when you found your partner. Every day is a blessing when you have friends and family. Every day is a blessing when you're confident in loving yourself. That every day is a blessing even when you're having a hard time. Every day is a moment to consider what this opportunity is going to give you and inspire you and how it's going to make you better. And that's awesome. That's really, really awesome. Thank you for watching. I really hope you have the most fantastic day. And I'll talk to you guys soon. Bye.
Stuck in my head, in real life while I'm in bed. My belly's being fed and I'm okay. I'm just fine, yet all I do is whine. Not to you in my mind, cause I know I don't make sense. I've been nothing but blessed. So why's my life a mess? Please tell me, cause I'm sick of thinking. Yeah, I'm sick of reaching out for the truth. And living life is a fool.